ના વિદ્યાર્થી લક્ષ સ્કૂલ ઓફ સાયન્સ ઓનલાઈન ટીચિંગમાં તમારું હાર્દિક સ્વાગત છે. જય હિન્દ વાલી મિત્રો, પ્રિય વિદ્યાર્થીઓ અને માન્ય પેરેન્ટ્સ, તમે જાણો જ છો આ મહામારી દરમિયાન બધાની જ નાણાકીય સ્થિતિ સારી નથી, છતાં લક્ષ સ્કૂલ ઓફ સાયન્સે ઘણી ધીરજ ધરી ઓનલાઈન ટીચિંગ ચાલુ રાખ્યું છે. આમ લક્ષ સ્કૂલ પોતાની ફરજ ચૂકી નથી, તો આપણે આપણી ફરજ ચૂકવીશી જ ને. તો વિદ્યાર્થી મિત્રો, વાલીગણ, જે વિદ્યાર્થીની ગયા વર્ષની ફી બાકી છે એ ભરી દેવા અમારી નમ્ર વિનંતી છે.
પ્રિય વિદ્યાર્થી મિત્રો અને માનનીય પેરેન્ટ્સ, આપણે ઓનલાઈન ટીચિંગ ચાલુ જ નથી રાખ્યું, પણ અન્ય કરતાં આપણે ઘણું સારું કાર્ય પણ કર્યું છે. હવે ઓનલાઈન ટીચિંગ લગભગ 5 મહિના થવા આવ્યા, તો ચાલુ સત્રની 3 માસિક કે 6 માસિક ફી તો ભરાવવી જ જોઈએ. હજુ આપણે ઘણું કાર્ય આગળ કરવાનું છે, માટે શિક્ષકો અને સંસ્થાનો જુસ્સો જળવાયેલો રહે. જો ફી ભરાશે તો એ પર આધારિત શિક્ષક પરિવારના ઘર પણ ચાલશે. આ મહામારી દરમિયાન આપણે એકબીજાનો સહકાર બનીએ.
જય હિન્દ વિદ્યાર્થી મિત્રો અને વાલી મિત્રો, આપ સર્વે આ ફી નિયમિત ભરી ઓનલાઈન ટીચિંગ માટે શાળાના શિક્ષકો અને મેનેજમેન્ટનો ઉત્સાહ વધારશો, સંસ્થાને નિયમિત આર્થિક સહકાર આપી આપના બાળકની શૈક્ષણિક કારકિર્દીને વધારે વેગવંતી અને સશક્ત બનાવશો. સો ઇટ્સ અ વોલ હમ્બલ રિક્વેસ્ટ ટુ ઓલ ઓફ યુ ટુ પે ધ ફીસ એઝ સૂન એઝ પોસિબલ. થેન્ક યુ સો મચ.
વેલકમ ડિયર સ્ટુડન્ટ્સ ટુ ધ લક્ષ સ્કૂલ ઓફ સાયન્સ. ટુડે વી આર ગોઈંગ ટુ સ્ટાર્ટ અ ન્યુ લેસન, લેસન નંબર 6, કેમિસ્ટ્રી, આઇસોલેશન્સ ઓફ એલિમેન્ટ. ડિયર સ્ટુડન્ટ્સ, this lesson is our examination, unit examination given by board, and that's why we are taking this lesson. This lesson is having 4 marks only, 2 marks MCQ and 2 marks will be asked from this. And the important part for the lesson is not so much harder, because you have studied that in 10th standard, like flotation process, magnetic separation, electrolysis, and that's all is going to come in this lesson. So hope that you will enjoy this lesson very nicely and will not have any problem anymore. But the introduction section is given too long, much lengthy section. So today only we are going to complete only the introduction sections. There is nothing in introductions, but the things are given in this way. The history of civilizations is linked to the use of in antiquity in many ways. Different period early human civilizations have been named after metals. For example, Bronze Age, Stone Age, Iron Age. So why we are talking about this? See, the name of lesson is Isolations of Element from its Ore. So first of all, we have to think that actually in this world going on, so when the origination of the earth, if we talk about then from the sun, when earth was created at that time, it is so hot balloon of the gases, but passage of the it is start to going to cool, and due to that cooling process the earth has developed several elements, several compounds, several minerals and several aqueous important thing also, and that is start to the cover the hottest region of the earth. And with this, the hottest region of the inner area was remain yet hot, and that is known as today magma. And you are seeing that magma in the center of earth. And with this, the iron, the nickel, the aluminium, the gold, platinum, like precious and important metals are developed, and we are going to talk about these metals and that. Okay, so the skill of the metals gave many metals and brought about several changes in the human society. See, if we talk about the iron, then iron has given us lots of industrial revolution. If we talk about aluminium, the aviation become very easy by means of this aluminium. If we talk about the gold has given lots of ornaments to us. So that's why these are very vital, important and very precious. Talk about the metal. Okay, it gave weapons, tools, ornaments, utensils, etc. and enriched the sculpture life. The seven metals of antique, as they are the sometimes called, are gold, copper, silver, lead, tin, iron and mercury. So ancient times, the seven metals were very precious, and the name of these seven metals are gold, copper, silver. This is the precious gold, copper, silver, lead, tin, iron and mercury. Mercury is also one precious metal, so that you have to keep in mind. Although the modern metallurgy has exponential growth after the industrial revolution, it is interesting to note that many modern concepts in the metallurgy have their roots in ancient practice predated the industrial revolution. So just I told, after the discovery of the iron, the industrial was done, and this industrial revolution has given everything to us. Okay, so although we have modern technology techniques, lots of techniques, but to remember, this modern technology always depends on the ancient technology. Whatever that there is very in primitive age, this today we are in advance, but the roots are very attached with the ancient practice. Okay, so ancient practice will give us the industrial revolution. Over 7000 years India has had a rich tradition of metallurgical skill. So if we talk the world level, so for over 7000 years it is written, we have the idea about the metallurgy. So what is your meaning of metallurgy? So my meaning of the metallurgy is very simple. Metallurgy is a skill from which we have to extract the metal from the its compound ores. And what to do for that? That very vital, very important, and that thing we are going to talk about in this lesson. So hope that you will understand this very nicely. So the two important sources of the history of Indian metallurgy are archaeological excavations and lit evidence. So here, if we are going to talk about the evidence, okay, why we are telling that before 7000 we had knowledge of the metallurgy. For that purpose we have two evidence. Okay, see, archaeological evidence and literary evidence. Okay, here I would like to add something. Dear students, if we talk about the archaeological evidence, so what does it mean? What is in our favor? For that purpose we use the archaeological evidence. But what is in our not our favor, then we are not using archaeological level. This is not good. This is not a good practice in my mind. So this archaeological evidence we are taking here for the proof that we have this and this. Okay, but same thing when I will tell that archaeological evidence are telling that we are never been any God gifted. We are only the creature of the earth, and by means of the evolutions we are reached here to, then this archaeological evidence are not so happy with that. So we are mean. The first evidence of metal in Indian continent comes from the Mehrgarh in Balochistan, where a small copper bead dated about 6000 BCE was found. It is however tough to be copper, which has not been extracted from the ore. See, interesting top. In Balochistan, okay, today it is in, I think so, Afghanistan or Pakistan, that is the Mehrgarh, okay, from there, small copper bead, dated about 6000 बिफोर क्राइस्ट. ओके सो फ्रॉम टुडे वी विल काउंट डैन 8000 ईयर अगो. इट्स हाउएवर टफ टू बी नेटिव कॉपर विच हैज नॉट बीन एक्सट्रैक्टेड फ्रॉम द ओर. ओके बट इज द टॉक दैट इट वॉज नॉट एक्सट्रैक्टेड फ्रॉम द ओर. स्पेक्ट्रोमेट्रिक ऑन कॉपर और सैंपल ऑब्टेन फ्रॉम द एशियन माइंस पिट्स एट खेतरी इन राजस्थान एंड ऑन मेटल सैंपल्स कट फ्रॉम द रिप्रेजेंटेटिव आर्टिफैक्टेड रिकवर्ड फ्रॉम द मिथल इन हरियाणा एंड 8 अदर साइट डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड इन राजस्थान गुजरात मध्य प्रदेश एंड महाराष्ट्र प्रूव दैट कॉपर मेटलर्जी इन इंडिया डेटस बैक टू द कैल्कोलिथिक कल्चर सब कॉन्टिनेंट. इन कैल्कोलिथिक कॉपर ऑब्जेक्ट्स वर इन ऑल प्रोबेबिलिटी इंडिजेनियसली. ओके नाउ व्हाट इट्स इंटरेस्टिंग इफ वी टॉक अबाउट द कॉपर देन दिस स्पेक्ट्रोमेट्रिक स्टडी. स्पेक्ट्रोमेट्रिक्स मीन्स spectrums that which kind of material we are having. So this spectral spectrums, you know that spectrum has several idea. In the spectrum, if the lines, spectrum means lines are some particular thing, then we can say that here the 7 lines are there means it is sodium, 14 lines are there means it is copper. So if in that from spectrometry, if we have material and we able to find out the lines, then we can confirm that it is copper. So, and copper is compound from where? So the place for first place is the Khetri in the Rajasthan. And if we talk about the another talk, then the Mitathal in Haryana, and also 7 is Rajasthan, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, and that all prove that the metal was the very common. Metal was the very common. Copper was the very common metal we were using. Okay, and that is known as Chalcolithic cultures. So in culture, Indian copper objects are very very optimistic to obtain. Okay, so that we understand about the talk. The ore for the extraction of metal for making the object was obtained from the chalcopyrite ore depends in Aravalli Hills. So now why it is known as chalcolithic period? So it is chalcolithic period because the ore whatever we obtained from the earth was nothing but the chalcopyrite, and that's why this is known as the chalcolithic period of the copper. Okay, so the ore of for extraction of metal for making the object was obtained from the chalcopyrite in Aravalli. Now you know Aravalli is nothing but the started from the Abu Ambaji, and that all Aravalli, and that is going to up to meet to Vidhyanchal is going up to south and also up to the wide range of the Mount India. So collection text from copper plates and rock inscriptions have been compiled and survey of India during the past century. So past century about the our culture, our archaeology on the archaeological level, that we all in this royal records were Amrapatra. So Amrapatra is nothing but the we records. કોઈ એક રાજા હોય, રાજાની હિસ્ટ્રી છે, પછી એની ફેમિલીઝ મેમ્બરના નામ છે કે એને કંઈક નવું કામ કરેલું છે. સો ધેટ પર પ્લેસ. ઓકે સો ધેટ ઓલ સેઝ ધેટ વી હેવ લોંગ ઇન્ડિયા. અર્લીએસ્ટ નોન કોપર પ્લેટ હેઝ અ મોરિયન રેકોર્ડ ધેટ મેન્શન્સ ફિમાઇન રિલીફર્સ. ઓકે સો વોટ એવર ધ મોરિયન પીરિયડ that also recorded in Tamrapatra. It has one of the very few pre-Ashoka Brahmi inscription in India. So Tamrapatra are nothing but copper plates are nothing but this in if we say about our history, then it was found out from the Maurya culture. Culture is nothing but the culture of the pre-Ashoka period. So also Maurya. Okay, after that the one incident he has taken out the Buddhism. But before that, he was Mauryan and he was the powerful king of the India. Okay? So, Harappans also used gold and silver. Now, that is the real surprise. Harappan civilization, we know that it is very, 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 very ancient civilizations, and it is nearby 3000 to 5000 between Harappan civilizations, and they were using the silver as well as their joint alloy electrum. Okay, so not only they are using the gold and silver, but they are utilizing their compounds also, and that is a very important thing. Variety of ornaments such as the pendants, mangles, beads and rings have been found in the ceramic of bronze pot, and not only these precious metals like gold and silver, but they were using the precious metal by the human, and that is nothing but the bronze. So lots of bangles, lots of beads and lots of ring have been found out in the ceramic or early gold and silver ornaments have been found from Indus Valley sites such as the Mohenjo-daro in 3000 BC. The period 3000 BC to 5000 BC is the period of Indian culture, which was in at the proxim level, and that's why we can that yes, we were a good cultured. These are on display on the National Museum, New Delhi. India has the distinctions of having the deepest ancient gold mines in the world. Maski region of the Karnataka carving places them in mid first millennium BCE. This is the big horn that make the difference. 1 millennium BCE. Very clicky. Okay. Hymns of the Rigveda. Hymns means sloka. Okay, of the Rigveda gives early indirect reference to the alluvial placer gold. So alluvial placer gold. So India has the gold depositions, but as which are earlier culture, so we have detected out everything and we have taken out everything. Now in the other world, they are not so cultured. Today they are going to be cultured, and that's it. Today they are taking. So that's why they have more gold. The River Sindhu was an important source of gold in the ancient times. So this is also one important talk. The river, which river? Sindhu River is also evident, was the initial source of the gold in ancient time. It is interesting that the availability of alluvial placer gold in the River Sindhu has been reported in modern time also. So today also we are seeing that availability of the alluvial places of gold in the River Sindhu. So River Sindhu is coming from the nearby Himalayan region, and there from that in its alluvial it is out the gold, and that's why it is good to hear, okay, that we have gold today also, such what we were using in past. It has been reported that there are great mines of gold in the region of Mansarovar and in Thokjalyang even now. So today also in Mansa Thokjalyug, then even today we have the gold resources, but yet we recover that. The Pali texts, the Aguntra Nikaya narrates the process of the recovery of gold dust or particles from the alluvial placer gold deposit. So how from this alluvial gold deposit, how we take out the dust of the gold and particle of the gold, that was written in the Pali text in Anguttara Nikaya narrates. Okay, so then find out that book, we will go with that. Although evidence of the gold refining is available in Vedic text, it is the Kautilya Arthashastra, authored probably in 3rd or 4th century BC during. So Maurya era was the very, very powerful era for the take out the gold, silver and metal from the earth. That era has given lots of things to India, which has much data on the prevailing chemical practice in a long sections of mines, including metal ores of gold, silver, copper, tin and iron. So this is the data of the Kautilya. Kautilya is also Chandragupta, repartner of the or the partner of the Chandragupta Maurya. Okay, so Maurya era has this thing, and this is the evidence in which it is written. So in the book of Kautilya, Chanakya, we used to speak. So in Chanakya book, that is the Charshastra, we have the evidence of the written metals like gold, silver, copper, lead, tin and iron. Kautilya describes a world called, see now there at that time that was also there, and which gold was there, that we are going to Rasvidda, which is a naturally occurring gold solution. It's about the such solution, it is recognize such solutions. So yes, it is external, recognize the situation, that is not. Okay, so remember the word Rasvidda. Now, it's depending upon the nature and almost of impurity present, it is likely that there are different colors of native driving force for the development of gold. Recent actions in central parts of the Ganga's valleys and Vindhya hills have shown that the iron was produced there post 100 BC. So now, the native gold means the our native India, when we get, that is the different colors gold, and depending upon the nature, almost of purity no under je pramane hoy, e pramane no color hoy. It is likely that the different colors of the native gold were a major driving force for the development of gold. Juda juda color na gold apne banaya che. So that is the excavations in central parts of, that is the thing about the thinking. Now recent excavation in chemical part, central parts of the Ganga Valley and with hills have shown that okay, we have iron, and our iron history is nearby 1800 BC. Gold history was 3000 BC, and the iron history is 1800 BC. In the recent excavations conducted by the Uttar Pradesh State's archaeologists, iron furnace artifacts, tuyas and layers of the slag have been found. Okay, in Ganga region. Radiocarbon dating place them between, okay, so these are the 1000 to 1800 BC. The result of the excavation indicate the knowledge of iron smelting and manufacturing of artifacts was well known in the Eastern Vidyas, and it was in the central Ganga plains at least from the early second millennium BC. The quantity and type of iron artifacts and the level of the technical advancement indicate that the working of iron would have been introduced much earlier. So see, we have lots of evidence here that in past we have lots of healthy and big culture, and that were using metal, non-metals and even so this is the idea of this instance of revelations. Now further, the evidence indicate early use of iron in other areas of the country too, which proves that India was indeed in independent center for the development of the working of iron smelting, and the use of iron was especially in South India megacultures. The foreign iron seems to have been at peak in India in the first millennium century. Okay, so if we now we come out from the BC, now we are entered into the past Christ, and in past Christ we have the iron culture in our South India, and in South India this was the megalithic, means very very developed culture. Okay, so Greek accounts report the manufacture of the steel in India by crucible process, very simple process we using the metals. In this process, coal and glass were mixed together in a crucible and heated until the iron melted and absorbed the carbon. India was a major innovator in the productions of advanced quality steel. Okay, see, if we talk about the Tipu Sultan. And that is made up of iron. But the layer of the nanocarbon on that is very logical thing to understand how we were developed in past. India was an innovator in the production of the advanced quality steel. Indian steel was called the wonder material of the Orients. See, that was the talk. Wonder material of Orient, the Orient. A Roman historian, Quintin Curtius, recorded one gift Porus of Taxila, okay, that is now 326 BCA, gave to the Alexander the Great was some 2.5 ton of wood steel. Now, wood steel is a primary iron containing a high proportion of carbon, that is 1.1 to 1.9. Woods is the English version of the word ukku, which is used for the steel in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. So, ukku means woods. Okay, so woods steel was the very strong steel, and it was containing carbon. So, non-corrosible. So that is the talk of the day. Now, literary accounting suggests that the southern part of the Indian subcontinent was exported to the Arab world. It becomes prominent named as a Damascus. Actually, Damascus steel. Michael Faraday tried to duplicate this steel with a variety of metals, including noble metals. When iron ore is reduced in the solid state by using charcoal, porous iron blocks are formed. Therefore, those iron blocks are also called sponge iron blocks. Okay, any useful product can be obtained from this material only after removing porosity by hot forging. So at that time, the hot that we used to speak as a furnace. Okay, so furnace were very important into the India, and in that furnace, the iron is first melted out at strong heat, and then porous thing, and this porous thing is now removed by the introducing different metal. The iron so obtained is termed as a rough iron, and exciting example of the rough iron production in ancient in the world famous iron pillar. So we have lots of iron pillar in our area, lots of. Okay, in Patan also there is the pillars are till today as it is. So if we are today using steel, within the 10 to 20 years they are going to disappear, but these pillars are still intact. So is the surprising. It was erected in the prisons in Delhi in the 5th century CE. The Sanskrit inscriptions engraved on the suggest that it was brought here from the elsewhere during the period. So that was the Gupta period talk. The arranged compositions of rough weight percentage, the components of the present in the rough iron of the pillar beside iron are 0.15%, 0.05% silicon, 0.05% manganese, 0.025% phosphorus, 0.005%, 0.03% copper, and 0.02% of nitrogen. The most significant aspect of the pillar is that there is no sign of corrosion in spite of the fact that been exposed to the atmosphere about 1600 years, the 1600 years before it was the established, but yet it is that is the bright point of the talk. Radiocarbon dating of the charcoal from iron revealed evidence of the continuous melting in the Khasi hills of the Meghalaya. The slag layer, which is dated 350 BC to 128 CE, indicate that Khasi Hills region is the earliest iron smelting site studied in the entire region of the Northeast India. The remnants of the former iron or excavations iron manufacture are visible even now in the landscape of the Khasi Hills. British naturalist player in early 19th century described the iron industry that had developed in the upper part of the Khasi Hills. So Khasi Hills has a lots of idea about the development of iron. So that is our history to talk. Now, there is archaeological evidence of in Rajasthan mines at 2th to 5th century before. So see, we first talk about the gold and silver, then after we have talked about the iron, now we are going to talk about the zinc. Zinc also be in our culture. It is also before the 5th and 6th century BCE, means it is before Christ. India was the first country to the zinc distillations. Okay, so due to low boiling point, zinc tends to its ore is melted. Pure zinc could be used after a sophisticated downward distillation technique in which the vapor was condenses in lower container. So that we know, okay, zinc has lower melting points and that's why it will rapidly become the vapor while other thing will as it is. Now this vapor is the condensed out and the we will obtain pure zinc. So that was the down displacement method, and that you know in 10th century you have studied. Okay, this technique was also applied to the mercury. Indian metallurgists were the in this techniques. This has been described in Sanskrit text of the 14th century. So this is also evidence of literacy evidence and archaeological evidence. Both evidence are there that we are using zinc. Indian knowledge about the mercury. Now it is talk of mercury. They use it for the medicine purpose. Development of the mining and metallurgy declined during the British colonial era. By the 19th century, once fluorosis mines of the Rajasthan were abandoned and become almost extinct. In 1947, when India got independence, European literature on science had already found it was to the country. Thus, in post-independence era, the government of India initiated the process of nation building through the establishment of the various institutes of the science and technology. In the following sections, we will learn the methods of the extraction of metal. Okay, so dear students, this was the only introduction lecture. And it is the longest history given in thing, and that we have completed. I hope that you understand this, and we'll meet again with the various thing. Thank you very much.